Listening Library presents Iggy Rules the Animal Kingdom by Annie Barrows. Read for you by Kate Reinders. Chapter 1. Maturity. A Bad Idea. Grownups are funny people. Irrational. Illogical. Immetrical. Okay, that's not a real word, but it sounds good with the other two. Grown-ups actually make no sense at all. Take, for example, babies. Grown-ups love babies. They love babies even though they're little, bald, useless lumps. In fact, they love them because they're little, bald, useless lumps. Grown-ups cuddle them and feed them and rock them. They even clean up their poopy diapers. Do grown-ups say to babies, "We've been thinking, and it's time you demonstrated more sense of responsibility"? No. Do they say to babies, "We expect more mature behavior"? No. Babies are just about the most immature and irresponsible people on Earth, and grown-ups are crazy about them. So why, when you turn 8 or 9 or 10 or 11, do maturity and responsibility suddenly become your grown-ups' favorite things ever? Here you were, thinking your grown-ups liked immature, irresponsible behavior, and now, without warning, you start to get in trouble for it. This is unfair. This is changing the rules in the middle of the game, also called moving the goalposts, which is just a nice way to say cheating, because even I could make a goal if I moved the goalpost right next to my foot. Besides, you shouldn't have to tell your grown-ups this, but apparently you do. You are, after all, just a kid. You're not old enough to be mature. And furthermore, would they really like it if you were mature? If you started sighing and talking about traffic and complaining about your back and your hair, would your grown-ups be happy? Do you think it would look better if I dyed it? Which brings up another point. If grown-ups are so fired up about maturity, why are they always complaining about being old? They don't make it sound like much fun. They should think about this.
"So I'll tell you about my back. It all began one day when I was 27. No, wait, I must have been 28 because that was the year I started to like tea. What? What? Speak up."
We are not going to think about it because we have some other stuff to do. Specifically, we are going to learn about a surprising thing that happened to Iggy Frangie. Who is Iggy Frangie, you ask? Really? You haven't read the other books about him? Sheesh. Iggy Frangie is a kid. He's 9 years old. What more do you need to know? Okay, fine. Here's some more. Iggy Frangie is generous, hardworking, brave, resourceful, and caring. He has tried to protect his family from crime, even though they didn't appreciate it. He has tried to help others, especially with their teeth. He has taught people things they never knew before, mostly about gardening supplies. If you had read the other books, you would know all this. Just saying. Yes, Iggy Frangie is an inspiration to those around him. Which makes it all the more surprising that Iggy's mom and dad ever wanted him to be different. But they did. Chapter 2. Iggy's non-existent puppy. In order for you to understand why Iggy's mom and dad surprisingly wanted him to be different, you need to know something about Iggy. It's not a surprising thing. It's a completely normal and reasonable thing. Iggy wanted a puppy. Iggy had always wanted a puppy. As far back as he could remember, he'd wanted a puppy. In Iggy's opinion, he was the kind of kid who was supposed to have a puppy. He knew how happy he'd be all the time if he had a puppy. On sunny days, he and the puppy would go to the park. He'd throw the ball and the puppy would chase it. On cold nights, the puppy would sleep next to him and they'd both be warm. When Iggy had homework, his puppy would sit next to his desk, lifting his head to give Iggy a sympathetic look every now and then. When Iggy's friends came over, they'd want to play with the puppy because the puppy was so much fun. But in the end, the puppy would trot back to Iggy because he'd always love Iggy the best. Iggy didn't even care what kind of puppy it was. That's how much he wanted one. Big or small, didn't matter. Though it couldn't be one of those teeny-weeny ones that quivered. Long hair or short, didn't matter. Though it couldn't be one of those goofy ones with puffy balls of fuzz on its ankles. It didn't even have to be a puppy. It could be a grown-up dog. Though it couldn't be one of those gross ones with crusty eyes. You are probably asking why, if Iggy wanted a puppy so much, he had no puppy. Iggy had asked that very question. In fact, he had asked his parents that very question about 500 times. Why did he ask the same question 500 times? Did he forget the answer? No, he didn't. He was just hoping the answer would change. Actually, his parents gave him lots of different answers. Here's one. "Oh, Iggy, we have too much going on around here to get a dog." Iggy looked around the house and saw nothing going on. That's why he wanted a dog. Here's another. "Nobody has time to take care of a dog."
Iggy did.
Or, "This place is already a mess, and a dog would make it worse." What mess? There was no mess. And then, the tough one, the big one, the one that Iggy couldn't deny or fight or solve. "Dogs make your dad sneeze." What could Iggy say to that? "Let's get rid of Dad!" Of course not. Dad was great, except for the sneezing. So the years went on, and Iggy remained puppyless. Then came a certain Sunday afternoon in March. You know how Sunday afternoons are, right? Long. All the weekend fun you were looking forward to is over, and tomorrow is Monday and school and the regular boring hard things. Nothing is fun enough on a Sunday afternoon. This certain Sunday afternoon was no different. Iggy was bored. He was bored, and he was mad about being bored because it was the weekend and he should have been having fun, not slumping around. First, he slumped around in his room. Then he slumped around in the front yard. Finally, he slumped around in the backyard. He boinged on the trampoline. He threw a tennis ball at the back of the garage. He lifted one of the paving stones to see if there was a snake under it. Nope. He pulled his shirt up over his head and staggered around, just in case he ever had to escape from his backyard blindfolded. He crashed into the shed. It didn't hurt much, but he fell over anyway, because maybe someone was watching. Someone who would rush outside and say, "Are you all right? Do you need some candy?" Nobody rushed outside. Iggy got up. He looked at the shed. He hadn't been inside the shed for a while. He had almost forgotten what was in there. Maybe there was something good, like money, or a sword, or the crazy glue, which had disappeared from the tool drawer after Iggy used it. We are not going to discuss this event. Slumping no more, Iggy opened the door of the shed, dived in, and, ugh, he spat out a mouthful of spiderwebs. Then he began to search among the bicycles and camping gear. A sword is pretty big, but money and crazy glue aren't, so he had to look inside all the backpacks. He found a toothpick. He found a flashlight and flicked it on. There! Now he could see all the money that had been tucked into backpack pockets. There wasn't any. Not even a quarter. No crazy glue either. Did Iggy give up? No! Iggy stuck to it! He shoved his way through the bicycles, ouch, until he got behind them, where there was a metal cupboard, the perfect place to hide a sword. He flung open the doors and found tin cans, a first aid kit, a rope, a bunch of flower pots. Boring. Iggy decided to go back to slumping. But as he was turning to leave, his flashlight beamed on a mysterious object in the farthest corner of the shed. He peered at it. He peered some more. It looked like a... But how could it be? It couldn't... But it was... It was a dog training crate. Just in case you don't know what that is, a dog training crate is a big plastic or wire box you put puppies in to teach them not to wake up in the middle of the night and howl. Iggy knew what it was.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.